from my previous webinars, you already know that food can help us to lower our stress level and anxiety. If you feel nervous, you can eat chocolate and feel better. If you had a tough day, a nice dinner with a glass of wine can help you to forget about your bad day and relax. Food helps us with fatigue, anger, loneliness, and almost every possible emotion that exists. Again, if you haven't watched my previous webinars yet, watch them after this one. In order to understand how we are emotionally dependent on food, let's talk about how emotional eating is developed. From the moment we are born, through our childhood, teenage years, and into our adulthood. I will start with newborns. When a baby is born, the only way that he can communicate with his mother is through crying. When a baby is crying, the most common reaction for the mother is to feed the baby. If the baby does not eat, then the mother tries to determine what else could be causing him to cry. The baby is learning, no matter what the situation is, I have to eat first. If I feel discomfort, if I feel pain, if I am afraid, or if I need attention, first I must eat, and then I can have my other needs attended to. So, if a mother is having trouble understanding why the baby is crying and having a hard time fulfilling the baby's needs, then the baby can start to develop a mechanism of substituting his emotions, his needs, his desires with food. When the baby grows up and becomes a toddler, this mechanism can become stronger. Between ages 2 and 3, the baby can start manipulating their appearance. This is the way they are learning their boundaries and testing their appearance. A 3 or 4-year-old can cry, scream, and throw a tantrum when he wants to get something from his parents. In order to calm down a child, parents, grandparents, nannies will offer food to the child saying, "Oh, please don't cry, honey, please don't cry, sweetheart. How about if we go and get some ice cream?" Or parents can say, "Who wants to have pizza tonight?" Often parents are trying to distract the child with promises that they will give them a candy, an ice cream, or some other type of food. Again, instead of solving the problem, kids are learning how to shift their awareness from the problem towards food. The preschool period. The baby is growing and it's time for daycare, preschool, and kindergarten. In preschool, children learn that there are other kids around them and that they have to compromise. A child might come home from kindergarten crying or sad because another child did not share his toy. The parents might feel bad for their little one, and in order to make him feel good, they can say something like, "Oh, you had a tough day. Let's make it better. Let's go to your favorite frozen yogurt place." The child is learning again that when he has a bad day, he can cheer himself up with food. The next stage is elementary and middle school. The child is growing and attending elementary school and middle school. This is a time for school parties, birthdays, sleepovers, and school competitions. Most of those events include pizza, hot dogs, candy, french fries, cupcakes, and soda. Here, a child develops a new mechanism. All of the happiest events in their life are paired with unhealthy food. They build an association between unhealthy food and happiness, unhealthy food and friendship, unhealthy food and victory, unhealthy food and joy. A birthday party is not a birthday party without pizza, chips, and cake. You cannot celebrate any event without a dessert. When a child wins a school competition and receives an award, the parents feel proud. Parents want to celebrate this achievement. They may take a child to a restaurant or let them invite friends over. The parents say, "You deserve it, son. Today you can do anything you want because you won this award. I'm proud of you. This is your day. Tell me, what do you want to do? Where do you want to go to celebrate? What should we order? Again, celebration comes with lots of calories. When people get excited, they cannot control how much they eat, especially when other people are still eating. Overall, we always eat more than we need during a party. To summarize, a child is learning that when life is good, when you hang out with friends, when you celebrate an event, you have the full right to eat as much unhealthy food as you want. Let's move on. The next stage is the late teenage years. At this point, we have already developed our food habits. At this stage of development, the parents have less leverage over the happiness of their child. This is the time when a child can be moody and distant. The parents are struggling to connect with the child emotionally. When a teenage son comes home in a bad mood, his mother can't comfort him as she used to. A mother who sees that her child is in a bad mood might go for what has always worked. She might say, "I ordered pizza for dinner. Honey, let's come and eat." So again, a child is learning, he's actually confirming that food can bring happiness, food can change your mood. And finally, adulthood. At this point, it is almost certain that this behavior will continue into adulthood. When a husband comes home angry and emotional, his wife might say, "Come down and eat first. I made your favorite lamb chops and bought your favorite ice cream." This is the way we were raised, and now we are raising our kids. We are repeating patterns that we learned from our parents. We cannot change our parents. They raised us only the way they knew how. The past is in the past. We cannot judge their decisions and blame them for what they did or did not do. Blaming our parents won't bring us positive results. We might end up in a bigger misunderstanding and conflict with them. What we can do is to change our own lives, our own belief system, and create new behaviors, new reactions that will benefit us going forward. We cannot judge our parents because we also make mistakes raising our own kids. The most important thing here to understand is we have to notice our own detrimental behaviors and limiting beliefs and start working on them. The good news is being aware of what you eat can help you identify which emotions or feelings you're trying to suppress. Please watch my free webinar entitled "Tell Me What You Eat and I Will Tell You What Problems You Have." The link is below the video.